Hi, I'm Norman Weilberger. In today's lecture, we're going to have a chance to review material on rational trigonometry by going over the solutions to the quiz that we had last time. Question one had a triangle, and we were asked to find the quadrances and spreads of that triangle together with its quadrant area. The side lengths being 3, 2, and 4, the quadrances are the squares of the side lengths. The spreads of the triangle, which replace the notion of angles, are found by the cross laws. There are three of them. Here's the one that corresponds to the spread S3. If we take 4 plus 16 minus 9 and square that, then we get 4 times 4 times 16 times 1 minus S3. So we can calculate that S3 is 135 over 256. And similarly, we can find S1 and S2 having these values. The quadrilateral of the triangle here is the difference between the two sides of the triple quad formula. It's 4 times this, minus, again, this combination, 4 plus 16 minus 9 squared. Turns out to be 135. And the area is given by this. Our quadrilateral is 16 times area squared. So the area is the square root of 135 divided by 16, which in this case turns out to be 3 over 4 times root 15. Question 2, we had a crane whose height we wanted to find. We've had a spread of 4/5 at this observation point, and a spread of 16 over 25 here. And we know that these two points are separated by a distance of 100, and so a quadrant of 100 squared. We want to find this height, or the square of it, the quadrant h. One way of proceeding is to first find the spread here. We'll call it S. The three spreads of the triangle always satisfy the triple spread formula, which is this quadratic equation. There's an S there, an S there, an S there. When we solve that, we get a quadratic equation, which in this case factors this way. There are two solutions. One of them, 4 over 125, corresponds to a different triangle, where this side here is actually on that side, and the triangle intersects way up there. So the one that we want is S equals 4/5. Now if that spread is S equals 4/5, then these two are the same. That means this triangle is isosceles. And so this quadrant, BC, is the same as this one, namely 100 squared. So once we know this quadrant, to find H, it's simply that H over this quadrant is that spread. So H equals 100 squared times this spread, 16 over 24. And then the height that we want is the square root of that, giving us 80. Question 3, we had a kite. Its dimensions were 2, 2, 5, 5, and so the quadrances are 4, 4, 25, and 25. And we're also told that this spread here is 1/4. We want to find these various lengths here, so we start by calling each of these equal quadrants Q. So now in this triangle here, we have the cross law, this plus this minus this quadrant, which is 4 cubed, all squared, is 4 times this, times 1 minus that spread. So there's the cross law, a quadratic equation for Q, which gives us these two values. Well, one of them is too big. The one that we want is the smaller value, 25 over 4 times 2 minus root 3. Once we have that quadrant there, then finding this quadrant is easy because that's a right triangle with Pythagoras. R equals 4 minus Q, which turns out to be that. And finding this quadrant from this right triangle is easy. T is equal to 25 minus Q, again by Pythagoras. So we get these two values for R and T, and then the lengths that we're interested in are simply the square roots of these three quantities. In question 4, we had an A4 piece of paper which we folded along the diagonal. Folded it over so that this point went up to that point there. And we were asked to find the distance between these two points. And we're assuming that this is 1 and this is root 2 in length. So in quadrants, this is 1 and this is 2. Well, and that's going to be 3 by Pythagoras' theorem. And in this triangle here, we know already that this quadrant is 1 because it's the same as that one, folded over. This quadrant is 2, So all we need is that spread S, and we'll be able to find quadrants Q. How do we find S? Well, the observation we need is that this spread right here is exactly the same as this spread, because it's obtained from this spread by folding it over. So these three spreads, S, 1/3, and 2/3, are the three spreads formed by three concurrent lines. Let's have a look at that situation. It's a bit interesting. So here are these three lines in general making a spread S, R, and T. The thing that we should observe is that if we move that line parallel, say over there, then the spreads that it makes with the other two lines don't change. So this new triangle here also has spreads R, S, and T. And that means that those three spreads must satisfy the triple spread formula. So even in a situation where you have three concurrent lines, the three spreads satisfy the triple spread formula. So these three numbers satisfy the triple spread formula. It's a quadratic equation. You solve it as usual. You get two values, S equals 1 or S equals 1/9. S equals 1 is impossible. That would be perpendicularity. So we have S equals 1/9. Then back up here, once we know that's 1/9, then in this triangle here, the cross lot gives us this expression for Q. We solve it. We get 17 over 3, or 1/3. That's too big. The right answer is 1/3. And so the separation between the two points, the length, the distance, is 1 over the square root of 3. Question 5 involved a cyclic quadrilateral. So we have a circle and four points on it. And we're told that the various lengths of the sides are 2, 3, 4, and 5, meaning that the quadrants are 4, 9, 16, and 25. And we're asked to find the radius of that circle. So what you have to do is you have to think about a diagonal of this quadrilateral, let's say that one, and let's call its quadrants Q. We're going to try to find out what Q is. We also need to observe that the spread here and the spread here, call it S, are both the same because they subtend that common chord of the circle. So let's have a look at these two triangles separately and look at the cross law in each one of them. In this triangle, the cross law involving that spread there has this form, with the 4, the 25, and the Q being the three sides. In the other triangle, the cross law involving the S has this form, with sides 9, 16, and Q involved. When we look at these two formulas, they both involve Q and this 1 minus S factor, we can eliminate the 1 minus S factor. So in other words, you solve for 1 minus S in, say, the second equation, and substitute into the first equation. Then you get an equation with no S's, only Q's, and this is what it looks like. Then you look at that and you say, oh, that's a quadratic equation in Q. So you rearrange it, solve the quadratic equation, you get two solutions, Q equals 49 and Q equals 299 over 11. Now it's sort of interesting what these two solutions tell you. Both of them are legitimate, but the one corresponding to this particular picture is the smaller Q. There is another picture where these two triangles are both on the same side of the chord, and the radius is much bigger. So the one, this one here, we'll use that one. And then the idea is to use this formula for the radius of the circle, because that's the circumquadrance of one of the triangles. So in the video where I talked about centers of triangles, we established this formula for the circumquadrance of a triangle involving the three quadrants of the triangle and the quadrilateral. The radius of the triangle is then the square root of that. In our next video, we're going to look at the final two problems on the quiz, questions number 6 and 7. And question 7 in particular is rather interesting. If you'd like a clue as to how to proceed at that, have a look at my website and have a look at the paper called Survivor, the Trigonometry Challenge. We'll deal with that next time. I'm Norman Wahlberger. Thanks for listening.